an annual production of about 300,000 tons a year against a demand of about 450,000 tons, the palm oil production sector in Cameroon faces structural deficit every year. Now, from aging plantations to lack of access to adequate infrastructure and the use of obsolete milling mills, the problems facing the sector are numerous. Now, in the last 48 hours, international NGO, the Worldwide Fund for Nature, WWF, has been drilling journalists in the nation's economic capital, Douala, on their role in promoting sustainable palm oil production. The program is Planet Rise on Canal English. I'm Regina Leke, your regular host. I'll be right back. Hello, once more, welcome, and thank you so much for joining us in this edition of Planet Rise on Canal English. Now, joining me to talk about the subject, which is so important, is the business and industry assistant for the Worldwide Fund for Nature, WWF, Madam Fideline Mboringong. Hello, and thanks for joining us into this edition of the program.
Hello, Regina, and thanks for having me.
Okay, fine. And on her left, yeah, we equally have a journalist who is working with a community radio in Boya, the Southwest Regional Capital, the Bonakanda Rural Radio. He is Evambe Thompson. It's a pleasure having a journalist on set for the first time, I must say.
Yeah, thank you. It's my pleasure. The pleasure must be, I think the pleasure is mine.
Now, over the last 48 hours, the Worldwide Fund for Nature has been drilling journalists in the nation's economic capital on their role in promoting sustainable palm oil production in Cameroon, and of course to help bridge the supply gap in Cameroon. Now, Madam Fideline, I would like to turn to you before we talk about the role, why WWF chose to train journalists. What do you mean? What does the concept and practice of sustainable palm oil production entail?
So basically, palm oil is one of those leading commodities when it comes that contribute directly to deforestation. And for us at WWF, what we are saying is we are not against the production of palm oil, but what we are saying basically is that our practices when it comes to palm oil production should be sustainable. And with this, we are saying that companies and smallholders should embrace best practices when it comes to when it comes to the production of palm oil. So we are looking at like being sensitive on where exactly we are planting our trees, and generally in terms of like practices when it comes to processes and all of that. So we are considering the environment where we are doing palm oil. We are looking at issues around people. How does the production of palm oil, how does it affect people, especially local communities where we have most of these plantations? We are thinking also about the economic benefits. I mean, like what's been bringing to communities and also to the country. So it has like all these
different parameters. Aspects,
different parameters that we are talking about. So we are actually saying there should be production of palm oil, but we don't want it anywhere and anyhow. So we need...
Especially in areas of high conservation value, I must say.
Exactly. Especially in areas of high conservation value, like around protected areas and all of that, and areas of virgin forest.
Of course, we are going to have time to really delve into the meaning of sustainability in the course of this program. But the WWF in the last 48 hours has been training over 20 journalists drawn from national and international press on their role in promoting sustainable palm oil production. My question to you, Madam Fideline, is why journalists you could decide to train those that are directly involved in the production of palm oil? Why did you choose to train journalists?
In the past 5 years, we have had the opportunity to engage with all the different stakeholders involved in along the palm oil value chain. Like, we have worked with smallholders that are the direct producers. We engage with agro-industries. We have looked at those that are working along the lines of the second transformation, like those producing, like the companies that are working
on satisfaire le marché local,
but
attaquer
for us,
le marché international, mais aussi produire de manière durable, c'est-à-dire en préservant l'environnement.
Like
pour développer cet aspect, les médias ont été ciblés et l'apprentissage.
Okay. And also with regards to the local communities, because this is really like the link between all these different stakeholders, and we have those in the media talking about these issues. But the idea was for the media to actually experience practically what it means to do the production.
I mean, it was very interesting because I had the opportunity to be part of the training, and we had to put our feet in the shoes of these different people in the different production chain. It was quite exciting.
Exactly, and that was the whole idea, to give you people like a first-hand experience of what happens in the field. And our idea also was to get the journalists into this, because we know now when you do reports with regards to palm oil, it wouldn't be superficial, if
yeah.
I can say that. But then it gives you, like, you put yourself into the producer, you're into the person doing the transformation and all of this. So it gives you, like, first-hand experience.
And equally the opportunity to be able to understand the problems that the different
exactly.
people in the different production, that's the production chain, face, and be able to project these problems, of course, with the sole objective of looking for answers. I'm going to turn to you, Mr. Evambe. Just to find out from you, Mr. Evambe Thompson, you are a journalist. You worked with a community radio. That's the Bonakanda Rural
Radio,
which is based in Boya, the Southwest Regional Capital. I'm sure as a journalist, you've had the opportunity to cover different issues, maybe politics, economy, culture. But attending this seminar or workshop, I would say, for 2 days on the promotion of sustainable palm oil production certainly added something new to your career, didn't it?
For sure, for sure. I must confess, in the course of the training, even when we had our invitations, we were coming in my own person. When I was coming, I knew I would come and sit and then watch a presentation being done with a PowerPoint. But when I came, I sat and then I saw the arrangement of the hall. It was surprising. Then I asked, where are we going to sit? How are we going to sit? Or what is going to take place? They said, just wait. I waited. All of the workshop became a role play. And being a journalist, I had to put myself, we know I'm a farmer to an extent, but not a
That's one of your roles you play in the game.
Yeah, but I just talk in a normal life. We all come from a background where all of us, we do agriculture.
Okay, fine.
But then, not in the palm sector, and we don't have that experience. But playing the game as part of the training in the workshop, it was like a revelation, because you could see everything in your face. And I wish maybe policymakers had the opportunity to stay with us in that workshop or play the same game, and then they could see where they are lacking as well. Because the idea is very difficult to educate somebody when you are using like a PowerPoint, or you are telling the person, giving the person the knowledge, like you are feeding the person. But if you allow this person to play the game like we did, you see that this is my fault, this is this person's fault, this is what I can do to remedy this situation, this other person knows. But so that is how I saw the game, and I think it was really interesting. And as a journalist, a community radio journalist, it has a change, it has a different mentality with the perspective that I
had.
Which
means you now better understand the process. And this brings me to my next question. How do you intend to transfer this knowledge that you've acquired for 2 days to the population that needs it most? I'm talking about the different people in the production chain, because we have a problem with, we have a deficit in palm oil, as I said earlier in my introduction, and Cameroon, a country that was once a leading palm oil producer, is facing a deficit of about 150,000 tons a year. That's a lot. So as a journalist, how are you going to transfer the knowledge that you've gained for us to get to that level where we can actually boost palm oil production in Cameroon?
Yeah, as a journalist, I must confess, after that training, I sat in my own reflection. I think it's a very big challenge for me, because with the experience that I had and what I could see, that the realities of everything, and it gave me that opportunity to imagine the type of programs, whether sports, be it micro programs, magazines, or maybe some documentaries. But then it gives me worry, like you know the truth. You try to tell somebody the truth, and then that person doesn't believe. How can you react to this? But now the idea is we have to go back. Fortunately for us, we have a community that really trusts the radio. We have a community.
Especially being a community radio is very close to the people.
For sure, we work proximately with the communities. We produce program in the local language.
Oh, that's very interesting.
Like that. And over 80.
In maybe big national radio stations, there could be a problem of language barrier.
Yeah.
But when you talk about producing a program in a local languages, it can permit maybe a farmer who does not master English language or French so well to be able to understand and fit himself in the situation.
And adding to that, the radio is a bridge even some of like the national station.
Okay.
Because in addition to our programs, we know the design of programs in the national station is different, but they have the capacity to get good information, reliable information as well. And we relay these stations, like the CRTV, so we can transmit informations like this again to the community where they cannot get into.
That's and reaching the local or national population.
Yeah. And then one other thing, we live in an environment where the plantation agriculture itself, it's very common. We have people with private owners. We have big corporations. Like we have, you have the Del Monte. For example, we have CDC. CDC is there. We have Dr. Ngongi, who also have a plantation, a palm plantation.
Okay.
But the idea through this training, I imagine, because I've once visited the plantation, you see aging plantation. The palms are not being well taken care of. Fertilizers are not being applied. And then the mechanism, whether to expand or whether to improve productivity, I don't think they apply all this knowledge. But the idea that I think they have always had or apply is to get the production, what the palms can produce at the moment is what they take. And when they have a bad harvest, is that the palms do not do well or the palms do not produce well. That's what I know, I've been seeing in the field. But if they can understand that, probably the inability for the palms not to produce well is either the technical aspect as to what the soil can give, the fertility of the soil.
Yeah, I think you're already delving into the next part of the program, or the next question, and I was going to turn to Madame Fideline. Now, in my introduction, I mentioned a deficit in palm oil production in Cameroon. I mean, just to find out from you, there should be some problems. I'm sure you cited some of these problems at the beginning, but what do you think must be done in Cameroon to be able to bridge this supply gap as far as palm oil production is concerned?
One of the main things we are advocating with, we are working both at the national, at the local level and at the national level. We are working with the government to see how we can put in place policies that support like the sustainable development of palm oil in Cameroon, and also just engaging. We have had the opportunity, maybe I should mention this, we have had the opportunity to bring to the platform some of the policymakers when it comes to the palm oil sector to actually have the same experience that the journalists had to play this game, and together for us to reflect like what are some of those strategic decisions we have to make when it comes to the palm oil sector. And I think there are many things that are being done, but I think we still need to go a long way in terms of like those policies we are putting in place in when it comes to the sector, and also the support that we give to smallholders, since the smallholders constitute a very big part of those that are actually working in terms of production. And we have realized with our engagement with smallholders that these smallholders have a lot of challenges in terms of like commodities, in terms of extraction of palm oil from the FFBs. So I think there's a lot that the government can do, especially to support this very vulnerable group, so that we can all work together as we strive towards increasing palm oil production, but at the same time, in a sustainable way, because at the same time we need to keep our environment safe.
Sure, and he mentioned something, and I would like you maybe to elaborate a little on that, because one of the reasons why the production of palm oil remains, I mean, we have this deficit in the country. There are some problems like very aging plantations. I mean, we're talking about plantations like the palm oil CDC that are more than about 40 years or so, or even more. And we equally have that's the lack of knowledge on the application of fertilizer. What we are looking at the way forward, what is your, you are an expert in this domain, what is your proposal to companies to that are dealing in palm oil production, even that's to large scale producers and even the
small holders.
Thank you very much. What is your proposal to them? What must they do? Do they need to, you know, to regenerate their plantation? What should they do?
Basically, I think like we need to do replanting, maybe in the same area for most of the very aging plantations. And for the smallholders, one of the things we have tried to do in the last 5 years is to see how we also bring the agro industries, the very big industries that have some of those resources that the smallholders don't have, bring them together and see how they can work together. We are not there yet, but we are actually in the process, and we think that these are some of the things that we can actually promote, like building these synergies between agro industries and smallholders so that they can together work in improving the extraction rates. But at the same time also, we think the smallholders really need to come together, because together they have that strong voice where they can advocate for more things and support. But it's
difficult. They can equally get loans from the bank.
Loans, exactly.
Because one of the problems for smallholders is access to loans. Some of them are giving loans at very high interest rate. But we understand under a cooperative, it could be much.
Yeah, it could. I think it could be much easier for you to have that, because as an individual, it's difficult for you maybe to justify to the bank in terms of like collateral security and all of that for them to give you a loan.
Journaliste
but I think
coming
together
Regina
gives them
Leke,
a more powerful voice for them to be able to demand and also to bargain
in
terms of bargaining, even with this,
bigger
companies.
Now, what have been some of the success stories of WWF as far as improving or promoting sustainable agriculture in Cameroon is concerned?
So basically, with regards to our work on agriculture in the past 5 years, we have focused mostly on working on palm oil, because basically, you know, our core business is focused on promoting issues around
conservation
of biodiversity.
Yes.
And we were focused on palm oil because we realized, like in 2012, from a report that we did with regards to oil palm development in the Congo Basin, that palm oil was one of those key drivers of deforestation in the sub-region. So basically what we have done was like, one of the main success has been on raising awareness on the issues of like issuing a concession, big concessions to agro industries, which is something the government stopped temporarily. They're still thinking about.
Yeah, because there was a big debate about an agro industry that wanted to expand into a high conservation area. We are not going to dwell about that. I think that brought a lot of problems because the indigents of that part of the country were revolting against the fact that this company was not only going to take away their livelihood, but was equally going to pose a threat to some of the already very endangered species we had in the forest.
Exactly. And also we have been engaging with agro industries and exploring ways to see how these agro industries can push for sustainability in their activities. And some of them are beginning to show interest with regards to certification of palm oil, even though this is a voluntary standard. This is voluntary, but then it helps when we talk about sustainability in the sector. And basically with small...
Some of them like which... Okay, fine, no publicity. Okay, I'm going to turn to you, Mr. Evambe Thompson. Now, as you know, environmental issues don't make headline news in Cameroon. I mean, as a journalist, do you think that the fact that environmental issues don't make headline news have kind of affected the attention that they are given?
Yes, I do think so to an extent, because I see... In my own radio, I will use my radio as an example. We have a program that is called Climate Change, Our Concern. And that is a program that we started since 2012. And it was surprising to me that at one time when I was working in the community, a friend of mine, each time he sees me, he will just shout, Climate Change, Our Concern, which means he has been listening. And this tells me that if we include topics like this in our discussion, daily discussion, it becomes very familiar with our daily activities as well. And then secondly, if we equally begin talking about the environment, not only as journalists, also while we start our at our very early age at the educational cycle, I think it brings a lot of awareness to an extent that probably when you are even working on the street and you have a piece of paper, to dump it, you find it as a taboo. But without the environmental education, if we keep it aside, you walk on the road, whether you have whatever you have, maybe can or plastic, you drop it as if it's just normal. I think the idea that mostly, as of now, journalists keep environmental education away from their reporting, or very often they don't report on the environment, is one of those aspects that is making the environment, the situation of our environment, or our environmental situation, to be what it is today. But notwithstanding, I think our educational system itself has to see to an extent that it inculcates this as this issue, for it to be much better.
Yes, actually, because it always beats my imagination. Of course, that is one of the reasons why Planet Rise was born, to be able to shine a light on those that are taking positive steps to save, protect our environment, and of course, to raise, to look into problems the environment is facing and propose solutions. It beats my imagination when you look at, you would hardly find a big newspaper headline about an environmental issue. Maybe they might wait until when it's at a disaster state. Like, for example, we have the proliferation of waste in the nation's economic capital and other parts of the country. Some of these waste, they go to block waterways, and this sometimes contributes to floods. So maybe newspapers and media organs will rather wait when there are floods, and they will say 9 people die of flood. Whereas, if maybe proper investigation can be done and these issues are raised, policymakers will be able to take a step to will be able to act on those issues for us to have solutions. Now, my question to you, Mr. Evambe, is what do you think can be done to sort of change this narrative?
Okay, at the level of our various media organs, it's left at the level of the editorial policy to see on how we, for example, if your media organ or your boss did not permit you to have this program, this program would not have been here.
Sure.
And I think through this program, a lot of people are learning about the environment. And then also we have at the level of maybe at the level of the government itself, or maybe even at the parliament itself, at the level of the parliament, they have to see to it that the aspect about environment is not only sung when for example, when a disaster happens, then they know that,
or when it's World Environment Day. Thank
sure.
you.
And things like that. For example, now, if we have flood in Limbe, then they start looking for issues. Okay, there was flood. What was wrong? Maybe we have to clean the drainage. These are things that they have to take into consideration, even maybe allocate budgets for things like this.
Definitely.
Because if there is a budget, therefore an activity has to take place. Without budget, there is no activity.
I think proprietors of media organs equally have a responsibility to play. Well, thankfully for us here, we have this program. But for other media organs, it may not be the same thing.
Sure.
So it's a clarion call we are making today. Now I'm going to turn to you, Madam Fideline. Now, my question is, aside from just training journalists on sustainable palm oil production, does WWF have any, has it put in place any mechanism to permit journalists to go down to the field and report some of these issues, especially we're talking about palm oil production? Because from my understanding, a media proprietor would rather sponsor a journalist to go and cover some political event, and may not really, it may not really mean much for him to send somebody, say, to Ndian to find out. So does WWF have any plan of putting in place some funding that can permit journalists from such training to be able to put what they have learned into actual practice, bring it on the media?
So basically, what we have done in the past is we have had opportunities where we actually take some media organs to the field with us, which is something we plan to continue doing, but we haven't had like an opportunity, depending on the particular issue we are looking at the time. But we haven't had the opportunity maybe like to take a very big team of media personnel to the field, which is something we are looking at in the future. But notwithstanding, we think that within the office, within the organization, we have opportunities where we can support this kind of initiative. It just suffices maybe for us to get a good proposal on like, this is what we want to do. And also within WWF as a network, we have like different scholarship schemes where journalists interested in issues around environment could apply maybe for funding. and get funding to do like initiatives like that. So they actually those different opportunities and different platforms we are exploring on how we can bring in the media more on issues like this.
We have in about 2 minutes to the end of the program, but before we go, maybe we have some last words, Mr. Evambe Thompson of the Bonakanda Rural Radio.
Yeah, my last word would be that I think other organizations, other NGOs, and even the Ministry of Environment and Protection of Nature itself should copy examples like what WWF is doing, because it's very hard to get an educational forum from the Ministry of Environment. It's sad to say that, but it's true. We only do cover events when they have events. We do report events, and from their events we can do analysis, but they don't educate us on what is going on the ground. I think if this can be done, the situation of environmental awareness will be very much enhanced, and we are very grateful to WWF, and I think Radio Bonakanda is committed to talk about environment.
And Madam Fideline Mboringong, any last words?
So basically, I'm just going to say, when it comes to the issue about sustainability in palm oil and regarding the environment as a whole, it's everyone's responsibility. It's not just a particular group of people. And I think we can do sustainable palm oil, but in a sustainable way, and not just anywhere.
Thank you so much for coming.
Yeah,
we had quite an interesting debate, and I was actually privileged to have been part of that very enriching workshop. But for now, ladies and gentlemen, that's the end of this edition of Planet Rise on Canal English. Thanks so much for taking the appointment with us. Until be another time, goodbye. God bless.